figure out to get here. I was trying to figure out if that was really the most direct way to get back.
I actually came from, like, the Sultan area.
Uh-huh.
And I had never driven 203 before through Duval and everything. Uh-huh. And I was like, I'm driving towards Bellevue right now. However, it's getting more and more rural as I go. It's beautiful out there.
Yeah, I bet it is the way you think.
Yes, yeah. It was the most scenic drive I've done in a while.
Well, cool.
It was very nice.
I came from Issaquah, so it was kind of...
You just pop right in. I mean,
no. Yes.
Really? Traffic, or?
No, I mean, this is a half hour. I live in, like, downtown Issaquah.
Yeah?
This is, like, a half hour.
From the main drag.
This is, like, this is plateau just goes on. I mean, it's, like, development after development.
I guess because I came from up north, I didn't realize where, to what degree in Sammamish we are.
Yeah.
Yes.
No, it's like another world.
It is. But it's so close, yet so different.
Yeah.
It's very refreshing. So this goes for an hour today, correct?
I hope so, because I have to catch a bus in this club at 4.
What's public transportation like on the plateau?
Well, I drove here, but I want to go into downtown Seattle, and I never drive.
Fair enough.
I'm going to take the bus whenever I can, but I didn't
hire
to do that.
Sure. No, exactly. That's what I was wondering. Yeah. It doesn't seem feasible out in this area.
No, I bet it would take forever.
Sure, yeah. So I was like, 30 minutes, maybe that makes more sense.
Yeah.
Be interesting.
It should be.
I'm excited to see all of them together.
Yeah. Have you heard any of them before?
Yes, I've heard Dr. Hader and Dr. Schreier both individually. I haven't heard from Jason. But.
Oh, so there's only three? I thought there were.
I think
interesting. So some have dropped out probably.
Or didn't show up.
But,
you know, the people that try and be anti-establishment view these opportunities as something they're not interested in. Maybe that's the case, or maybe they dropped out. You're right.
I can't imagine how much it costs even at the beginning of the
stage. Plus, the personal stake, you know? You're putting your everything out there, and everything's fair game.
Yeah.
Like,
that's true. I admire them.
Yeah, I did. I admire it if it's actual altruism. If it's actual self-sacrifice, I respect it. But if it's, there's a lot of people that'll bear that cross to get the power.
But I think that's the problem. What power do you really have? Is it power?
You have a lot.
Sure.
Excuse me, but I should have said from this district, you would have a lot no matter what.
Yes.
Because the amount
of
capital,
that's true.
The amount of just the GDP that that King County puts out is solid. But you're right. Generally speaking, if you aren't the senior person on a committee or if you're in that position, there's a lot of inertia that kind of keeps you from doing anything.
Yeah.
I agree.
So far, it looks like
we've
got this up together, and then
we're going to start. Just a few minutes late. It's not so bad. I will say I respect the sacrifice of time that they have to make. The fundraising alone, it's about 80% of it, and the fundraising alone is, I can't imagine it. I can't.
Indivisible Washington Z. push back against Donald Trump's dangerous and hateful agenda. And I couldn't be more proud of the things that our group has accomplished along with our coalition of indivisible groups, grassroots efforts across the district. We started in early on our Republican Congressman, Mr. Dave Riker, and we persuaded him to vote no against the ACA repeal when it was voted on in the House, which was a significant victory for him to vote against his party. And then in September, we heard that he wasn't going to run for re-election.
Yes.
Figured out that he wasn't going to be able to fly under the radar anymore and slide into another victory re-election, that he was going to have to come through us, and he decided he wasn't ready to do that. We worked really hard, and now it's time to turn to this 2018 midterms. I had an opportunity yesterday to hear from Senator Cory Booker, who was here in Seattle, and probably a lot of you got to see him at different events around the city. And he said something that really touched my heart. He said, "We luxuriate in democracy paid for by other people, those before us. We must protect it." And that's what we're doing, right, guys?
Yeah.
And he said that this is the most important midterm of our lifetime. So, as an indivisible grassroots activist group, we embarked on this endorsement process. Because we have a top two primary, we recognize what's at stake, and we want to make sure that we have a Democrat there on the ballot for the general. And we really wanted to have a grassroots, boots on the ground, deciding factor into who is going to come next January. And so we gathered together our coalition of six indivisible groups from across and around the district to do this endorsement. This group starts with one indivisible in Ashley, Ellensburg indivisible, where's Cheryl? Cheryl. Indivisible Puyallup, the CD8 Alliance, and our group Indivisible Washington's 8th District. We have put our heart and soul into this, and it is a fair process with integrity and a lot of transparency. It has been a ton of work, and so I'd like to recognize the volunteers. So with the endorsement committee and the interview committee, please stand up. Please register to vote, and we'll start. start voting on March 10th. Okay? So we've been working on defense for this past year, and now we're going on offense to fight back against Donald Trump. It's time to put our energy and our passion that we've been holding on to all year into flipping the eighth. So I couldn't be more proud of this team, and I'm so excited and grateful for you candidates for stepping forward. I've seen firsthand how hard you're working, so thank you all of you. Thank you. And I'd also like to thank my friend and host of the Indivisible Washington podcast, Stephen Cox.
Then each of the candidates will have the opportunity to ask a question of another candidate. And then finally, we're going to have questions from you in the audience. If you haven't had a chance to fill out one of the cards and you'd like to, please do that now and indicate on the card if the question is for a specific candidate or for all three candidates. Lisa with the red box over there, if you all see her, she is collecting the questions. So if you'd like to pass them to her, please do. So, ultimately, what we're going to try to do here today is to provide candidates the opportunity not only to impress you, the voters, but also to distinguish themselves from one another. Chris mentioned our values statement, which I know you all have as I've seen you looking at it. On the backside, you will find the candidate evaluation framework. Those are the criteria that we use in today's questions. And we're hoping this may be useful to you as you begin to evaluate the candidate. So, just a couple ground rules before we begin. We're going to ask you to refrain from any shouting or sign waving during the forum. Applause is fine. And also, if you have not done so already, please do remember to silence your cell phone. That's a reminder to me. Okay. And finally, I will be mentioning that we will be wrapping at 3:45, no later than 3:45, so you will have plenty of time to get this out in the lot. So, without further ado, let us welcome our candidates. Please welcome Shannon Hader, Jason Winterizer, and Kim Schreier. And so because all the answers that we are going to be requiring from them will be timed, we have two timekeepers seated on each aisle here. We have Alex and Steve. We have cards that say 60 seconds, 30 seconds, and stop. Can you please demonstrate that? So when you see the red, time to... All right. So now each of the candidates will have 90 seconds to introduce themselves and to tell you why they are running. We're going to go in alphabetical order here, so we will start.
Hi everybody, I'm Shannon Hader, Auburn girl, fifth generation, Auburn High School grad, became a doctor, served in the Commissioned Corps of the U.S. Public Health Service, stationed all over the country and all over the world, and essentially spent a professional lifetime learning how to make the federal government work for the people. And I think that experience is going to matter, because I am running for office to serve my home district. Because I truly believe that government should work for the people, and that's not happening. It's not happening for my parents or our neighbors across this district, and that's why I'm going to win, go to D.C., and make sure our voices are heard and served. So earlier this week, I spoke a little bit about how we get there. And I said, you know, we need a vigorous, free, and fair primary election, not a coronation. And I said, the general election candidate for this group has to be chosen by the people of the 8th and only the people of the 8th, not party insiders or DC outsiders or big money interests. And today I decided to take action. This morning, I launched an open letter from the people of the 8th district calling on every candidate in this race and every voter in this district to make our call known that the people of the 8th, not DC insiders or outsiders or party insiders, will decide this election. Keep our hands off meddling from our primary. We can get it done. Because I know the people in this district can choose who's best to serve them. So join me. I'll tell you more about it as we go on, because once we choose the people's choice candidate, we're going to rally around that person and win.
Next, Jason Redwright. Hi there. Thank you so much for being here. My name is Jason Redwright, and I was born and raised in this district. I grew up in Ellensburg, and growing up in Eastern Washington, I learned how hard it is for the middle class to get ahead. My dad was a law enforcement officer. He would come home at night, take off his uniform, put on a Domino's pizza t-shirt, and deliver pizzas in order to make ends meet for our family. My brother and I had the luxury of focusing on our education. I got a strong public school education, graduated from Ellensburg High School. My first job was on a hay farm in the Kittitas County. I paid for college by driving a swather and bucket hay. Got a degree in economics from the University of Washington, and went to work for Congressman Rick Larson in the 2nd District. Then to law school, came back to serve as a criminal prosecutor for King County, where I went to work every single day focused on protecting the community. Now, as an employment lawyer, I've worked hard to protect thousands of Washington workers and fight for their civil rights. You know, since the time I've had the right to vote in this country, we've been at war. We have gone through the worst recession in 100 years. And our climate is rapidly deteriorating. All that's been done about it is that rich people and big corporations have gotten ahead. The rest of us have been left behind. Our voices aren't being heard. I'm angry about where this country is headed. I'm running for Congress because it's time for the next generation of leaders to take on our greatest challenges, to stand up and fight for our values. It's time to govern with our morals again.
That's time.
I look forward to the conversation today, and I'm so glad to be here. Thank you.
Hi, it is really good to be right here in my home community and also with Indivisible, where basically my candidacy started. I am Kim Schreier, a local pediatrician, a wife, and a mom. I have deep roots in this district. I've taken care of thousands of children here, including some of your children. And I never thought I would do anything else, but the 2016 election rocked my world, and I presume most of you are here for the exact same reason. I have deep concerns about the health and the well-being of my patients and patients all over this district under this administration. In fact, such deep concerns that when that first Trump care bill was introduced, I went with three other docs, we met with Riker's office and explained all the ways that was bad for our patients, for the district, and for the country. 2 days later, we voted for it. Anyway, that was it. That was the last straw for me, because we all deserve better. We deserve representatives who will fight for us and our best interests, representatives who will fight for working families and for the interests of women and for the environment, and that is why I am running. And you know what? This is catching what I call grassroots Schreier fire. Thousands of people are supporting me in this race, and my average grassroots donor has given $35. And I am so excited to do this for the district. Thank you.
Okay, we will now begin with our round robin prepared questions. Each candidate will have 90 seconds to answer here, and we will begin in alphabetical order, and then we will rotate who goes first. So, question one. Most social policy analysts agree that we have reached historic levels of income and wealth inequality, creating significant challenges for working families. What legislation would you propose, or what current legislation would you back, that would do the greatest good for working Washingtonians? Please please be as specific as you can?
Sure, I'm going to talk about the multi-pronged approach to strengthening our families for good wages, good jobs, and a predictable future. Number one, we need to invest and build in a growing economy, not a growing minimum wage economy, but a growing good wage economy. And that means both looking at jobs now and building a pipeline as we go forward. STEM jobs, the new economy, preparing kids for jobs we can't even imagine yet so that we're leading this. Making sure that we are strengthening the unions that are under attack so that we can continue to, you know, fight the race to the bottom and instead make sure we've got qualified, trained, strong unions bargaining for high quality, good environmental standards and good health standards. We also need to flip the house so that we can recover from this tax giveaway that certainly just hurts our middle class families over time. We need to reinstitute the components of our tax code that help working families get ahead. And with all of that, I think there's another thing that we need to talk about, which is really having high aspirations. We'll talk a lot more today, I'm sure, about what is the future economy? How are we purposeful at transitioning current expertise into new jobs, whether those are green jobs, new products, or new leadership? So we need to invest not just in the future pipeline, but the current transitions and make sure no one is left behind.
Jen, I'm going to give you 30 seconds extra here because the specific question was, what legislation would you propose or what current legislation would you back that would do the greatest good for Washington?
Yeah, so I think the legislations that I would propose is, number one, let's remove the things that we got damaged in the tax code. I think this is an urgent, even though it's not a permanent fix, we need to strengthen the tax credits that help working families get ahead, whether it's child tax credits, whether it is elder care tax credits, and keep going. Second, we have had a week of threat for our unions. You know, there is an argument being held in the Supreme Court, or that was heard in the Supreme Court, about arguing that somehow paying fair share into a union is compromising free speech, which would be, you know, laughable if it weren't so damaging. We need to keep this right.
Thank you. Jason? Income inequality is the greatest threat to our democracy. I am part of a generation that for the first time in American history will be worse off than our parents. My parents are part of a generation that on a cop salary, you could save for retirement, you could buy a house, and you could also put two boys through college. And that is fundamentally no longer the American experience. You know, our economic policies have to start with the middle class. We have to focus on creating prosperity from the middle out in our country. And if I have the honor of going to DC, the first thing I'm gonna do is try to raise the minimum wage. We need to not just have a minimum wage, but a livable wage. We also need to focus on investments that create good-paying jobs. That means infrastructure investments. It means a fairer tax code. We all just shifted the largest shift of wealth in American history to the richest people and corporations, $1.5 trillion. It is time that we stop focusing on economic policy that is on the backs of working-class folks. It is time that we lift everybody up again. And I'm going to fight every single day, just like I have in my career, for working families again. Because that's who deserves our attention in D.C., and that's who deserves an advocate for this district. Okay.
Well, we are all deeply concerned about the widening gap between the 1% and everybody else in this country. And the recent tax bill just exacerbated that. There are several things that we can do to help working families all over this country. First one, let's address our healthcare crisis, because healthcare costs are the number one cause of bankruptcy in our country, and that is shameful. Second, we need to raise the minimum wage, and I would vote for at least a $15 minimum wage, because all studies show that when you raise the minimum wage, people do better and businesses do better. And not just that, there is no 40-year-old woman working a full-time job that should still live in poverty. And there is no college student coming home and working a minimum wage job that should have to live in their parents' basement. Third, for working families,
We need to support unions. And if you're asking about policy, I will fight any right to work law, because those essentially cut the legs off of unions, take away all their power, and the only way the little guy, the common people, have to advocate for themselves is the collective bargaining power of unions. That's what I would do.
Question two. You are currently in a room full of potential constituents. Now, you've just noted some legislative proposals. But beyond that, none of you has held elected office before, so please tell us how you plan to hit the ground running on our behalf if you're elected. And we'll start with Jason.
The obligation of a representative is to first listen and learn, and then ultimately help and lead back in Washington, D.C. That's when we launched this campaign back in July. We started with 30 town halls in 30 days, because it's the obligation of a representative not to just hold town halls, but to meet constituents and voters where they're at in the district. We went everywhere from Chelan County to Kittitas County to East Pierce County, South King County, all throughout this district, because the first thing you need to do in order to represent folks is to understand what they're going through, understand the issues that are important to them. We've already hit the ground running here in this campaign, and that's not going to stop if I get the honor of going to Washington, D.C. My office will be available. We will have people can access us throughout the entire district, whether you're in Wenatchee, Ellensburg, down south. But really, there's this theory about going to Washington, D.C. as a freshman representative, freshman congressman, that you need to show up and you need to wait your turn and you need to learn. I don't have time for that. Folks are hurting too much here. They need an advocate on day one, and that's exactly the type of representative I'll be in the United States Congress. We're not waiting in line for anybody else to determine what the priorities are here. We're going to Washington, D.C. to pass laws and create good paying jobs in this district. Thank you.
Well, we all see what happens when you have a lot of people with a lot of legislative experience in Washington, D.C. They get a whole lot of nothing done. They are so stuck in their partisan politics that they cannot see through it to really work for the people in this country. I firmly believe that our representatives should represent their communities. They should be people who live and work in the community, who understand the needs of the community. And who better than the pediatrician who works with families all over this community? Once elected, how will I be most effective? I think the best thing I can do is go in on day one, make friends with every Republican I can, because the only way that we will get past this hurdle is to figure out who we can work with on the other side of the aisle to make things better in this country. Ultimately, we need bipartisan solutions. Right now, people who are there are too caught up in the battles. It's hard to lay down your sword and make friends across the aisle. But if we want lasting solutions, we need bipartisan solutions. There's my first step.
Okay.
So I am new to being a politician, but I'm not new to politics, policies, or government service. My last job, I was the director of the Division of Global HIV and TB for the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. This is a big program, 2,000 people across 45 countries, $2.4 billion a year budget that I was responsible for driving outcomes up, quality up, and unit cost downs, and making sure we were getting results. My team, when I left, had delivered help contribute to the 2.2 million babies that have been born HIV-free because of the generosity of the American people. And you know what? That's a bipartisan program. It's a bipartisan program, and I've worked under four different administrations during my time in and out of the feds, so I know how government can and should work. I know the toolkit up on the Hill to get things done. Legislation is part of it, but it's more than that. It's also about oversight. So knowing how government agencies work on the inside so you can probe the questions, get the right answers, and discover what's wrong. It's about budget. So having the skills to have used and surgically managed huge budgets for huge outcomes. So again, you cannot take a hatchet to a budget, but a scalpel to redistribute to what's gonna matter to the people. and it's the convening power that I've spent a lifetime in the HIV community, bringing people together to understand voice and community and make sure voices are heard. So I'm gonna match my deep roots in this community, and my ability to listen, and start day one.
Question three. What makes you better than the other two candidates when it comes to getting out the inactive, Democrat-leaning, and independent voters in the 8th Congressional District in a non-presidential year?
You know, I could jokingly say that I have a lot of patient graduates who I will get to register to vote and come out for their pediatrician. The bottom line, as I said before, is that I think that my history of living in and working in this community is a huge advantage. People need to be represented by their neighbors, their coworkers, their doctors. Not just that, I am really invested in this community. I'm raising my family here. I have settled here. I have my child in public schools here. And that is why I will battle to do my very best for this district. As far as getting out the vote, boy, if Donald Trump and Paul Ryan are not getting out the vote, we've already got an issue. I will be in every corner of this district, meeting people, letting them know that they have a better choice and that Rossi will be another rubber stamp on this administration, and that will bring up the voters.
Yeah, I think I'm gonna do a great job getting out the voters because I have a fundamental appreciation for the fact that we are a purple district. We are a truly purple district. We will stay a purple district. We have families who are purple. And sometimes we have deep blue and sometimes we have deep red, but there's a lot of purple out there. And we've got to make sure the purple activates with the blue so that we can flip this district. I mentioned my bipartisan experience before working under four different administrations, but there's another part of that too. I'm a scientist, and not just a scientist, but a CDC scientist. So my way of talking, in many cases, tends to be, you know, sort of just the facts, ma'am, and not hyperbole, not rhetoric, but frankly, not without passion. And I think in a purple district, that matters, because people want to feel like they can be heard and express their opinion without judgment on the person who's listening. And I think my neighbors, and I've experienced this a lot, can understand that we're going to have policy differences. But what I'm asking them to do is to trust me, to listen carefully, to respect their opinion, and to know how to have a dialogue. And I have proof points and experience doing that that I think helps people to trust me and know that that's true. So my goal is to have a really strong field game. Lots of doors knocking, lots of telephone calls, asking people what they, you know, believe in, and delivering my credible proof points of having delivered for people in the past so they can trust me to deliver for them. And that's why I think I'm going to activate the blue and the purple in this district to help us win and beat Dina Rossi.
That's time. I actually represent the largest voting demographic in America today. I'm 33 years old, and I represent millennials in this district, and I represent the new generation of leaders that will help drive change in America that we desperately need. The millennial voting demographic in this district can dictate who the next congressman from this district is, plain and simple. We have an opportunity to generate interest from young folks again by pushing policies and change that they need. We're seeing it in Parkland, Florida right now. You know, I was born and raised in this district. This is not a Seattle suburb district. This is a district that is South King County and East Pierce County and Eastern Washington. I have lived in this community and I understand the urban and rural divide. I cut hay over in Eastern Washington and I've worked as an attorney in Western Washington. I've represented thousands of people in this state, fighting for their rights and fighting for workers' rights. We need somebody who understands how laws affect real people. We need somebody who has experience being an advocate for people. Look, this is going to be a sharp-elbowed sport here in politics. Dino Ross is going to be one of the most formidable candidates in the country in an open swing district. We need somebody who has the understanding, the background, the experience, and frankly, the energy to go after him and make sure we take back control of the House in 2018. I just want to ask very quickly, can we hear each of the candidates? We're all good?
Yes.
Matt, we're good. So next we'll have follow-up questions. Now these are based on interviews that our committee had with each of the candidates, and they will be asked directly to a specific candidate. And again, each candidate will have 90 seconds. Kim, our interview team had difficulty understanding how your skills as a pediatrician providing one-to-one care can translate to the skills required for success in Congress, where you'll be representing 600,000 constituents. So can you describe how your skill set as a physician translates to that of a congressperson, particularly with such tasks as coalition building, drafting legislation, managing staff, and other job requirements?
Of course. Well, as Jason alluded to, one of the primary jobs of a representative is to represent and to listen. I have spent my career listening, working with, and jointly problem solving. It's interesting. There's no way that all my patients could be Democrats, but I have 100% support from them because they know where my heart is, they know that I am thoughtful, they know that I will respectfully listen to all viewpoints before making an informed decision. I am ready to do that for the district. The other part of that question.
The other parts of the question were coalition building, drafting legislation, and managing staff.
I have a phenomenal coalition in my team. My coalition consists of labor union support because the labor union leaders, aerospace machinists, know that I will work for working families. I will represent working families and fight for them, and also that I will consult with them because I'm a pediatrician. I will need help with labor laws and trade. I'm also getting the support from Emily's List, part of my coalition, because they know I will fight for women's representation and women's rights. And within my small team, we have a diversity of ages and interests and opinion, and I consider them all, and we work together beautifully.
I'm going to give you an extra 30 seconds because we threw a lot at you. So I will want you to answer the question about drafting legislation and how your skills as a pediatrician will transmit that.
Of course. Well, thank God not everybody in Congress is a doctor, huh? We never know how to write legislation. This is why we work as a team. This is why we will have collaboration in Congress. It is why I will have a legislative aide and a political aide, and why I will have colleagues on both sides of the aisle, because we all bring different gifts to Congress. I will bring my insight, my moral compass, my concern about children and families and workers and women, and others will bring their ability to draft legislation properly, and we will get the job done.
Yes, constituents have expressed concern that our Congress is disproportionately represented by white male attorneys. How do you respond? You know, there's a couple things I don't have control over. You know, I focused a career on living my values. I came back from law school and went to work as a criminal prosecutor. Turns out, you don't make a bunch of money working as a criminal prosecutor. In fact, you make almost no money. In fact, we made such little money that they didn't even make us pay our bachelor's and loans at that point. But here's what I do know. I know how to represent people. I know that Congress is broken. Now, I'll be honest, it is broken by a bunch of old white men. And I'm prepared to go to D.C. and take that on. I do think that it's time for a next generation of leaders. I think that there is a separation between folks who go to D.C. and are beholden to big money interests and folks who aren't. Where many of the movements in this country have started is on our college campuses and our high schools. And I'm focused on channeling that energy and going to D.C. to bring a fresh and new perspective to Congress, to represent people, and to stand up for what's right, because that's what we need today. Again, you started the race later than the others. You are significantly behind in fundraising, endorsements, and building out a campaign infrastructure. How do you catch up to your primary opponents, not to mention the heavily funded Dino Ross?
Thanks. So, not everybody in this room might know that I was sort of a surprise candidate. And I was a surprise candidate because I had, as I mentioned, a really big job at CDC. And when I took that job, I committed to giving them 3 years. My 3 years was up mid-October, and I left the next pay period. The reason I was a surprise, though, is because there's also something called the Hatch Act, which is a law that essentially says if you are a federal employee, you can't run or even talk about running or like dip your toe into running for public office. And so I couldn't tell anyone I was coming until I had severed from the feds and I was here. So I knew I had to have a different pathway, not your typical spend 3 or 4 months telling people you might run, spend a couple months building an infrastructure, launch and start fundraising. Instead, I did that all in parallel in the last half of the 2017 quarter. I actually have a great team and an infrastructure, so I'm not behind in any of that. I started fundraising before I launched, and I was the only candidate to have pre-launch 6 figures plus in the bank. That's without a website and without anyone knowing what's coming. And so I'm committed to continuing to scale up those local commitments and endorsements. Mayor Nancy Backus of Auburn endorsed me, and she's a pretty tough cookie, as the candidate she thought is going to do the most for her community. Because I've made it very clear from day one, my priority for this job are the people of the 8th and only the people of the 8th. Thanks.
So I've noticed that and this is in the interest of time, please hold your applause for this conversation. Thank you. That. Next is our flash round. So we're going to be doing something a little bit different here. I am going to be reading off a series of short statements, and each candidate will respond with one of three cards. Green for agree, red for disagree, yellow for uncertain. I'm going to ask each of you, because we have folks that I may not be able to see with every answer, will you please hold it over your head so people can see how you're responding? Okay. So just once again, green for agree, red for disagree, yellow for uncertain. And at the end of each round of topics, each candidate will get 30 seconds to explain one and only one of the responses he or she would like to clarify. And if they pass, if there is nothing that they would like to explain, are we clear on the rules? Okay, let's begin. We'll begin with healthcare. Agree, disagree, or uncertain on the following statements. Every beneficiary of our health system should pay some portion of its cost, determined largely by their ability to pay. Congress should allow Medicare to negotiate drug prices to reduce costs. Medicaid funding should be transitioned to state-focused block grants. Contraception should be recognized as a core part of any state or employee-provided health insurance. I support the legalization of marijuana at the federal level. Federal law should be changed so government-provided health care will cover abortion. Big Pharma should be held legally accountable if their sales force has misrepresented the addictiveness of the opioids they sell.
What?
Has there anybody called mine? Physicians have overprescribed opioids and they should be held liable. Or rather, I realize I misread the question. Physicians who have overprescribed opioids should be held liable. The entry age for Medicare should be reduced to 55. The government should require children to be vaccinated for preventable diseases. Now, each candidate may have 30 seconds to clarify one of their answers where he or she can pass.
Let's see. I agree
that
maybe
it's
really important.
I gave a maybe to Medicare, reducing the age to 55. I think that people should be able to buy into Medicare at any age. Was there another one that anybody was confused about?
You're only allowed one.
No.
Jason? No, I think I'm pretty clear on where I stand.
I can no longer see anyone because the light is red. So if I'm a little confused, confused on my signs, that's why. I held up the yellow on physicians should be held individually liable on their prescription, you know, over-prescribing opioids, only because I think that we need to define that even more. I'm part of a generation of docs that when we went through medical school, it was right when OxyContin and Percocet was sort of being scaled up and marketed. And we were taught in medical school that if a person has real pain, you can't get addicted to the pain pills. And moreover, that for the last, you know, several decades, doctors have been evil and passionate and able. Okay. So the take home is, I think we need to better define what prescribing limits are, help doctors change their practice, and make sure the real evil of pill mills and deliberate marketing of addiction is shut down and very well prosecuted.
Jason, you don't want to keep those handy. We're motoring on. Next topic is gun rights. So agree, disagree, or uncertain on the following statements. The Second Amendment should be repealed. Current gun laws are adequate and just need to be enforced. Gun manufacturers should be held liable for mass shootings.
Yes.
We should implement enhanced background checks for purchases of all guns. At every school in the 8th District, we should allow teachers to be armed in the classroom and train and support those who desire to exit. Yeah. Even as we were writing that one. At every school in the 8th District, we should harden school sites with security fences, metal detectors, and armed guards. At every school in the 8th District, we should employ, train, empower, and empower counselors and mental health professionals to identify and treat those students who may pose a threat to students and staff. We should raise the age to 21 nationwide to own any firearm. All difference. We should reinstate the 1994 law that bans the manufacture of semi-automatic high-velocity rifles like the AR-15. And limits the size of their magazine for existing weapons to 10 rounds. That's the 1994 law. We should treat guns like we treat cars, register the owners, track the sales, license the operators, and require liability insurance. Individuals convicted of domestic abuse or who are under a restraining order should no longer have access to guns. I will accept campaign donations from the NRA. Cam, we'll start with you. You might clarify 30 seconds.
Mike.
So I think that we can get better solutions that combine across a lot of these questions to give us better results in terms of decreasing gun violence deaths and still preserving the Second Amendment. We have ways of doing this, and if we treat this like we treat other public health problems, we recognize both the mass shootings and the murders, but also the accidents and also the suicides, and look for solutions that can fix this, we can do more. We need to fund CDC to do gun violence research. We need to find out what works, and we need to implement it and spend the money taking it to scale.
I don't believe that military-style weapons have a place in our community. But when we're talking about weapons bans, what we're talking about is access. And as a criminal prosecutor who has worked on gun violence issues and the violent crime in this district, I know that the best way to prevent dangerous hands from getting guns is background checks. It's background checks, and it's also not enough just to deal with access. That's why King County is leading on this issue across the country with extreme arrest protection orders, because it's not enough just to deal with access. We actually have to take guns from dangerous hands before it's too late. I wrote a piece on this recently, and I think that it's time for Congress not just to fund that,
that's tempting,
but also adopt it.
Not only will I not take money from the NRA, I'm the only one up here who is calling out Dina Rossi for taking over $400,000 from the NRA, and also calling for us to hold every elected official who takes money from the NRA accountable. They need to be out of our politics.
Okay. We will now move on to immigration. The following statements are about immigration. Agree, disagree, uncertain. If I were presented with legislation that would secure DACA for the roughly 800,000 participants for their lifetimes in exchange
for $5 billion in border wall improvements or extensions with no amendments or side deals allowed, I would vote for that deal. State and local law enforcement should be required to determine all suspects' legal status, report any suspected illegal immigrants to ICE and FBI. Applicants for driver's licenses should be required to prove legal status. We should reduce immigration based on family reunification norms and increase the number of legal immigrants based on merit and needed job skills. We should require English language skills for all naturalized citizens. Adult undocumented immigrants should have access to government-subsidized health care. Undocumented immigrants should be offered in-state tuition rates at public colleges within their residing state. Babies born in the United States to non-citizen, quote-unquote, tourists should automatically receive citizenship. I support a path to citizenship for all immigrants already in the United States. Existing border protections should be strengthened. Okay, we have 30 seconds for each candidate to clarify if they can pass. Jason, we'll start with you.
Now I get the sun. One of the greatest, I think, moral failures of our Congress is that we are actively breaking a promise to 800,000 DACA recipients in America. If I was presented with a bill or an opportunity to protect DACA recipients, I would have a really, really hard time looking at them and saying no, because we're also going to put $5 billion towards securing our border wall. Now, I have zero...
That's time.
Let me say this. This is important. I have zero interest in a border wall on our south border. I think it's a racist monument, and I'll kick it down. I'll be honest, my generation, if you put up a wall, we're going to tear it down.
I agree that the decision between DACA and a wall is a ridiculous question. I said maybe only because if there were that money allocated for a wall, I would make sure it was the most complicated wall with the most regulations so they could never build it until well after the administration changes.
Yeah.
Listen, I'm a public health doc. Denying or putting barriers in the way to access health care services because someone's an immigrant or doesn't have full insurance or doesn't have the right, you know, documentation that people are looking for doesn't serve any of us. We need people to be healthy. We need our communities to be healthy. We need to make sure that we are intervening in health problems early, not late, and make sure that that is part of the fabric of who we are. And we can do that as we work our way towards 100% truly affordable, accessible health care for all.
Following statements concern the environment. Agree, disagree, uncertain. Human beings are causing climate change, and it's a problem that Congress must address. The U.S. should rejoin the Paris Climate Agreement. To provide more renewable energy, we should dam more rivers in Washington State. To provide more renewable energy, we should build nuclear power plants in Washington State. To provide more renewable energy, we should build more wind farms in Washington State. I support the carbon tax recently voted down in the Washington legislature. Washington State should prohibit the export of coal from all of its ports. Natural resources extracted from our national forest lands should be used to help promote our nation's financial growth. There's some difference, guys. Addressing climate change is more urgent than addressing immigration. Okay, you each have 30 seconds to explain a vote.
So really top in urgency in my climate portfolio is protecting our public lands, protecting them from from being sold off to the highest bidder, protecting them from being contaminated from all get out, but I also think we need to innovate. We are at high risk for forest fires. We've experienced in this year. There are some innovative approaches that want to look at removing some of the low quality underbrush and other kinds of lumber instead of just clear burning everything, using it to set up local mills and industries that make that quality of wood through new technologies now useful, and that could strengthen our economy and save the environment both.
Go ahead. Natural resources should not be extracted from our national forests, period. These are public lands. I am an advocate for public lands. I believe public lands should stay in public hands. The 8th Congressional District is the perfect place to be an advocate for our environment. We have renewable energy technology, 50% of the 8th District is public lands, and we have the best conservation and management in the country. Let's get behind those efforts. Let's fully fund the EPA, and let's actually drive towards protecting our planet again.
Next time.
Agree with Jason, and there is no reason that we cannot pursue sensible immigration reform and environmental protection at the same time.
Well, where are you at, man? I'm gonna pull a David Letterman. How are we doing on time? Moving on to the day, okay, we have one final statement. This is a standalone statement. Agree, disagree, or uncertain. If you were in office today, knowing what we know today, would you co-sponsor a House bill to start impeachment proceedings against President Trump? Knowing what we know right now. Okay, you have 30 seconds to clarify your answer.
Well, if the qualifier is knowing what we know now, then I have to say no, because look, as a prosecutor, it is a process in which you understand the facts and you apply the law. And I don't think any of us know right now, because everything has been sealed, because it is classified. If I get to Washington, D.C., and I have the evidence that is sufficient to bring impeachment, I'll be the most dogged prosecutor in that fight, I guarantee you. But until we get there, I'm not talking about it. Because we have too many problems to take care of now.
I have deep concerns about this president, this for office. I have deep concerns about Russian meddling in our elections, about profiting from the presidency. But I really want this Mueller investigation to play out. And if we are going to bring articles of impeachment, we better be darn sure that they are solid, and we need the Mueller investigation to play out first.
And Shannon.
So even the question is about right now, really the action is about what happens January 2019 when I'm in office. But I think really, I don't have a crystal ball for January 2019. I want to be optimistic. I want to believe that we will have flipped the House and that we will be able to address some key priorities like reversing the losses in healthcare and jobs and in the environment. Where we're at that point with meeting articles of impeachment, I think we'll see then. I'm not certain how far that will go, but I hope we're able to focus on some really important things and have the power to execute.
Okay, you guys, I know you're in the sun right now, so I'm going to suggest something. We're done with the flashcard round, so if you'd like, you can stand up, but just maybe stand up and see if that takes you out of the sun a little bit. Now you're No, man. Of all the days for it not to be cloudy. Okay, so now we move on to our candidates posing questions to one another. Each candidate may pose one question to one other candidate of their choosing. That candidate will then have 90 seconds to reply. Jason, we'll begin with you. One question to one person.
I have the same question for both, but I'll ask. We all seem to agree in universal health care. I'm the only non-doc here. So in Dr. Schreier, in your private practice, did you serve Medicaid patients, and if not, why?
The medical group that I work for, which is a hospital-affiliated group, does see people from all backgrounds, including patients on Medicaid. They do restrict the number of those patients simply because my understanding is that
They would not be able to stay afloat if they took all. And that is one of the problems with our medical system, that we all had the same coverage from the same body. This would not be an issue. We would have equal care for every person in this country.
Okay, Shannon? Oh, I'm sorry, but if we're going in order this way around, Kim, you would be the one to ask the question next. Yes.
Shannon, whenever I hear you talk about your experience at the CDC, I think about when I was in medical school, and I took care of, it was a tragic situation. A mom became infected with HIV while pregnant and didn't know it. No preventative medications could have been given, and this baby was born with HIV. And at that time, this was 1993, HIV AIDS was still a death sentence. It was absolutely devastating. So I wanted to thank you for your work, and I also wanted to see what more can be done at the federal level if and when I'm elected to help with AIDS prevention programs.
Great question. So I think there's a few things. I think even though we all want to strengthen ACA and work towards universal health care coverage, there's been a little bit of a challenge on the Hill with people thinking that because we have growing health insurance, we don't need a public health response anymore. One of our public health responses comes from CDC, and another comes from another agency in what's called the Ryan White Care Program, named after a 9-year-old boy who was discriminated against because he was living with AIDS. And this service funded to take care of people who did not have the money to be covered for HIV. That Ryan White Care Program is under tremendous threat. The budgets for CDC to activate national, for every state prevention programs are under threat as well. And so we need to continue to robustly fund and actually increase the restore the budgets to the Ryan White program, to CDC, and continue to invest in new research and development through the NIH and our academic partners, because we want a cure and we want a vaccine.
And Shannon, you can ask a question to one of the other candidates.
Okay, Kim, ask a question, Kim. So with the passage of the Trump tax giveaway, the federal government is facing massive budget deficits. And of course, Paul Ryan and the Republicans in Congress are plotting to cut Social Security and Medicare to solve the problem that they have created. Now, we all agree with that being wrong on this panel. There's no question about that. So the question is, what's the biggest budget you've ever managed, and how does that prepare you to make real impact at the federal budget in Congress?
I feel like that gauntlet was just thrown down in front of me by somebody who manages really big budgets. I manage a small budget. It's my family's budget. It's the kitchen table budget. But it does involve deciding about how we spend our money. And I think that the way that we spend our money says a lot about us as people and us as a society. And I would agree with you that when you give $1.5 trillion to the wealthiest in this country, that shows where this administration's values are, that we need to be investing in our social safety net, and that as a family, we try to keep our footprint, smaller. I drive a 25-year-old car, so if you're wondering who drove up in that jalopy, that was me. We balanced our budget at home.
Okay. Again, I need to hold that to applause, because we're really running short. We're going to turn to audience questions now. Each candidate will have 60 seconds to respond. I may not get to all the questions that you submitted, and I will apologize in advance if I don't get to yours, but again, this is a time issue, and we do need to be cleared out at about 3:45. So the first question concerns the primary. If you are trailing in the polls, at what point do you decide your participation in the primary does more harm than good to the Democratic cause and throw your weight to the leading candidate? We'll start this way, Shannon.
So I started today and I talked about the letter that I just released calling for the people of the 8th and only people of the 8th to determine who their primary candidate winner is to go up against Dina Rossi. And I truly believe that we can do that because I've watched the people in this room. I've watched all of you, our indivisibles, along with our resists and our flips and a bunch of other grassroots activities that have been successful in getting Dave Riker to step down.
So I have full confidence that no one is going to take away that win from you all, and that you all are going to determine who the best candidate is to beat Dino Rossi in the election. So I think that's what the primary is for, not leading up to the primary.
But the question is typically is there a point at which, if you're trailing, do you throw your weight behind the leading candidate?
Once the primary, so my answer to that is no. I really think that the people should decide. If there's a reason for me to stop running, I'll stop running. But I want the people to make the decision here, and I want to make sure that as soon as that primary is over, we all get behind the people's choice that was chosen in the primary, and we go forward and beat Dino Rossi together, and I know we can do it.
Okay. Jason, the question goes to you. There really is no question that this race is bigger than anybody sitting up here. The path of our country is going to be in part determined on the success in this race. Taking back control of the House of Representatives is greater than any individual's ambition. It is greater than anyone sitting up here. We have to win. We must beat Dino Rossi. I believe I'm the best candidate to do that, not just because of my background and experience, but my lived experience on both sides of the house. If at some point it becomes clear that I'm not the candidate to do that, we'll have those tough conversations. I think everything points to the fact that I am the candidate to take on Dino Rossi, I am the candidate to win, and I am the candidate to go to D.C. and shake things up. And that's exactly what we're committed to. And we'll keep fighting every single day to make sure the folks here understand that. Because it's an opportunity for you all to decide who can best represent you. Thank you.
Give me questions for you.
I absolutely agree with Jason that this is far bigger than any of us, that we need to set aside our egos and do what is best for the country and get a Democrat in the seat. I would agree with Shannon about letting a primary play out, but for the fact that we are in a top two state, and by having too many Democrats in this race, we risk shooting ourselves in the foot and getting two Republicans on that ticket and never having a prayer of getting a Democrat in that seat. We need to all set aside our egos, we need to narrow the field here, and we may need to have a hard discussion if another Republican jumps into this race. At this point, I am not planning on stepping out. I have 2,200 people supporting me in this campaign. I have hundreds of volunteers in a grassroots effort, and it will take grassroots, not money, to beat Dino Rossi.
So the next question concerns the hashtag MeToo movement. What legislation would you like to see to further the MeToo cause of equity? And I believe we started with, you've just finished answering the question, so Shannon, we'll start with you on this.
Okay, I support legislation at multiple levels. For helping particularly the broad public, I would make sure that we get rid of forced arbitration that limits the ability of workers to actually bring their complaints and get a response. Rules like that that keep everything wrong under cover and secrecy don't help defend people, and they don't help women feel empowered to lodge their complaint and make it safer from other women. Second, there is some legislation in the House right now that wants the Congress to lead by example, wants to set up the institutions within the Congress to make sure that there is a place for staff to report safe, not to have any backlash, again, not to be covered under the secrecy of arbitration, and certainly for any payouts not to be paid by the U.S. tax dollars. So, two-pronged.
The empowerment of victims through the Me Too movement is absolutely crucial to changing the conversation around sexual assault and sexual violence in this country. As a prosecutor, I was in the special assault unit. I prosecuted sex crimes. As an employment lawyer, I stand up against sexual harassment daily. If we're going to actually solve this problem in America, though, we've got to start before employment situations get out of control. We've got to start before sexual violence inflicts our communities. We need to have a serious conversation about sex ed in our school system. And we need to focus on not just teaching sex ed, but teaching healthy relationships to our children again to make sure that we're changing a dynamic in this country. If we're gonna stand up against sexual assault and sexual violence, we need to be loud, we need to be aggressive, and we need to give voices to victims to make sure that they can join the path to recovery. At It's something I've been committed to in my career. It's something I'll fight for every single day in the United States Congress. And we will create a difference. I promise you that.
Make no mistake, this is not just about sexual violence and harassment. This is about abuse of power. And one way to address this is to have more women in positions of leadership in this country. That sends a message that it will not be tolerated. In addition, I would say we should start from Congress and have standards across the aisle so that we do not only as Democrats self-resolve and self-discipline. We need this to be across the aisle, top-down, with transparent systems for reporting, evaluating, and addressing sexual assault and any abuse of power.
Okay, the next question, and we'll go back the other way this time. The next question is about foreign policy. List the top countries you have in foreign affairs. And we'll go with Kim first.
You know, the first thing that we need to do, and I really would argue this is one of the best investments that our country can make, is investing in our State Department and global foreign aid. Because one of the best things that we can do to help our country, to help our military, to help our soldiers, and to help avoid having to get into more conflict is to help stabilize the rest of the world. And sometimes this is as simple as food and dealing with famine and helping with local conflicts. But if we can raise the tide, then all ships do better. And it is critically important that we invest in peace efforts overseas, not just in bombs and guns.
Jason, what have you mentioned?
Government's first job is to protect its citizens. A foreign policy must be premised on that basic fact. Now, one thing that, I'll be frank, pisses me off is that we are less safe as a nation with this guy in the White House. He's tweeting, his hateful nationalist rhetoric makes us less safe. And on top of it, he starts increasing our defense budget and cutting our state budget. That is wrong-headed. It makes us less secure and puts us in danger across the country, and I'm fed up with it. We need somebody who understands foreign policy concerns, understands where we ought to be focused in this country, and where we ought to be driving towards interacting with other countries is around diplomacy. Diplomacy is what solves challenges across this country, across this globe. We've got problems in North Korea and in Russia and in Syria and Afghanistan and Iraq. We have been at war since I've had the right to vote in this country. We're bombing 11 nations right now.
And that's time.
Let's stop that.
Yeah, I lose sleep every night about our growing global insecurity thanks to the lack of leadership in this administration. I have spent probably half of my professional career working globally. A lot of that is working directly with our Department of State and our embassies and our ambassadors all over the world. And our Department of State under this president and Secretary Tillerson is being absolutely decimated. All the moves that have been made, even under previous Republican administrations, to strengthen, diversify, and build the future of our diplomatic corps have been undone. We need to rebuild the Department of State, recognize the power of diplomats, and reverse this isolationism that's being preached and go back to our, you know, construct of openness, knowing that we are smarter, stronger, wealthier, and safer when we open our arms and collaborate than we are when we isolate ourselves and sort of make the entire rest of the world angry at us. So.
Okay, the next question is about role models. Who do you admire in politics or political activism today, and why? You shared with the last time, Jason, we'll start with you on this one.
I'm going to answer this question in two parts, because I had the opportunity to listen to Cory Booker speak yesterday. Probably the most motivational, inspirational speech I've ever heard in person. I hadn't before yesterday necessarily looked up to Cory Booker as someone I would try to emulate or model myself after. But without question, following yesterday's conversation, he's a guy we should be paying attention to. But part of his message, which was really important, is that politics and leadership doesn't start in the United States Senate, it doesn't start in the United States Congress. Where it starts is right here. And so who I look up to are folks who don't have the title of congressman or senator. I look up to folks who show up every single day to do good to their community, to drive that person to church, to make sure that person got here to this debate today so they can participate in our democracy. Now, those are the heroes we ought to be looking up to.
Shannon, you?
Yeah, you know, of course it was on mine, I guess, because he showed up at Patty Murray's golden tennis shoes yesterday. But he's a great inspirational speaker, but beyond his speech, he is actually someone for certain qualities I've held up for a long time. He has been very purposeful about developing his skills, talents, and perspective to be able to serve his community. He's been thoughtful about that. He has engaged on his own personal way of staying connected and communicative with his community, and he models that behavior consistently. Now, I'm a different person with a different personality, but I think that very much that idea of how do you take every life, community, and professional experience you've had across time and channel it into being the best representative for you, for your community that you can be. How do you make sure to dedicate yourself to listening, to realizing what you might not be hearing, and to be really alert to unintended consequences of your good intentions? Those are the kind of elements that I would like to model, as well as, frankly, there are a few, there you go, that's good enough.
This has to do with disability rights.
I think it might turn. I'll forgive you. I was at that same lunch, and wow. I'm going to pick the other person there yesterday, Patty Murray. It was really fun to see her. People compared me, you know, mom in tennis shoes, and it was funny because I had parked so far away that I actually did run there in tennis shoes and then switched into my high heels. She is such a hard worker. She got into this for exactly the reasons I am getting into this, because I'm not happy with the status quo and we all need to roll up our sleeves and do something about it. She went into fight for her kids. I'm going to fight for my patients. She works hard and takes almost no credit for anything. She highlights others' achievements. And you know what else? She works across the aisle, and I would consider her a great role model.
Now, the next question has to do with disability rights. H.R. 620, which passed in the House, makes it more difficult for the disabled to challenge violations of the ADA law. What is your position on this legislation?
I'm against any weakening of our ADA legislation. And in fact, I not only support our ADA legislation, but I'd like to expand it. And I'd like to make sure that when we look across our other social programs as well, including Medicare, Medicaid, and Social Security, we are reducing restrictions and put thresholds at a point where we make people living with disabilities less secure. There are a lot of requirements right now that limit families and parents from investing in their children's future when they're struggling with disabilities. That if they put too much away to give their a steadiness, people lose their disability income and they lose their health care coverage. We want to make sure that everybody in this country has a stability that allows them to thrive, strive, work to the best of their ability, have the best quality of life, and not to be worried about losing their benefits if they just step a little bit over the line.
Jason, to you.
The American with Disabilities Act is premised on a simple thing, an ideal that I try to embody, which is equality. I took on a $1 billion corporation when they fired a woman because of her medical condition. That's a violation of the American with Disabilities Act. She was the oldest living, still is, the oldest living person with a condition called abscismus dysplasia. She has persevered through every type of odds. Literally the oldest living person in the country. And she was fired, she's a child care worker. She was fired by a $1 billion corporation because of her short stature. It's a bone condition. That is fundamentally wrong. We took on a $1 billion corporation. They flew in their fancy lawyers out of New York, and when we were done with them, she walked away with 10 years of her salary because nobody should be treated like that in this country. If we are trying to erode laws federal level that aren't based on equality, that don't protect people,
yes,
I'll stand up to them, just like I did to that corporation.
Kim, to you.
As a pediatrician who takes care of children and families of all abilities, I absolutely support strengthening of the American Disabilities Act and enforcing it. In a civilized society, we need to take care of one another. I really believe that is our responsibility and it is an American value. So taking care of less abled bodies is just like taking care of people with less financial security and taking care of our elderly and our sick. It is our responsibility to one another.
Okay, I have time for just a couple more, but I'll check with you in a second. Candidates and representatives can't know everything. Their success depends on their ability to assemble strong advisory circles. Who is in your circle who you would rely on for advice?
I already alluded to my circle. I have a great circle. First, I have my team. Second, I have the support of the Aerospace Machinists and the Painters Union. And they will advise me and counsel me on the details of trade, labor laws, the implications for workers with any decision that I make about employment, labor, trade. I have the support of Emily's List, and I will consult with them, although I don't know how much consultation I'll need, about women's rights and reproductive rights and making sure that women are in positions of authority. And I have more informal, what I call kitchen cabinets, an environmental kitchen cabinet that includes Dennis Hayes, the inventor of Earth Day, the founder of Earth Day, and an economic kitchen cabinet as well. So I seek advice from all corners, listen carefully, and then make informed decisions.
Jason.
First and foremost, my incredibly intelligent wife was here today. But you know, I'm confident that all of these candidates here we've all established advisory councils and groups that can help us understand complicated issues. Because here's really the role of a representative. You're not going to know everything. There are too many things going on every single day. But we have the honor to get to D.C. Every single one of our cabinets are on fire right now. And repairing those is going to take a whole bunch of expertise and a whole bunch of fields that not all of us are adept or equipped at. But here's where my background and experience comes in. As a lawyer, my obligation is to go into broken situations, to bring in experts, to fix those situations and come to solutions that we're not all ultimately going to be happy with, but that move the ball forward. We've assembled an advisory council. We have consultants and we have a team that I think is the best in this race. But the real obligation is to get to DC and fix the problems that exist.
Jen, do you?
So I spent a year on the Hill as a Robert Wood Johnson Hill Policy Fellow, and the first few months at the Institute of Medicine, learning like the whole spectrum of politics and policies and experts from red to blue on every single topic regarding health there is. And one of the first sort of like training lessons they gave us is that it was a bunch of docs and scientists around the table. And they said, okay, here's a question. How do you find out the answer? It was a policy question, right? And one of the docs raised his hand. It was a pediatric oncologist and says, well, first I do a literature search and look at the data. That's the wrong answer. The answer is you start calling up everyone who is an expert in this, different kinds of organizations. And if you're smart, you call not just the people already agree with. You know, you also call the people who you don't agree with to hear what the alternative issues, concerns, and arguments are. And so that's my approach now during the campaign, and will also be my approach while governing. I reach out to individuals and organizations, in addition to my great team I have, and solicit diverse opinions.
Okay.